Hello everyone. Today I would like to take you actually into a journey through my architectural career and the way how we are actually right now dealing with these robotic construction methodologies. And first of all, I would like to take you through four important doors in my life, in my architectural career. First one is my university, first university, Istanbul Technical University in Istanbul. After studying architecture in this university, I decided to move to London in 2003. And then I entered through this little door in London, in Bedford Square. Actually, this door opened my vision towards the new world of architecture. This building is Architectural Association, some of you might know, and I studied there a master studio, which is called Design Research Laboratory about architecture. I had amazing almost 2 years in this university, and this vision of architecture led me to another chapter in my career. So then I entered through this girls' entrance. This is Zaha Hadid Architects office in London. I spent almost 7 years with this amazing firm. We designed and built lots of buildings all over the world. I had chance to work close to her as well. And I spent almost 7 years entering through this girls' entrance and coming out from the boys' entrance, because this was a school building. And in time, Zaha, first she rented a small studio. It was called Studio 9. And in years' time, of course, right now they own the whole building. And around 2013, I decided to give a different direction to my career. And I decided to go to Istanbul, where I am from, and establish my own office. And in a way, taking a risk and restarting the whole process. Because after working with such an amazing worldwide known architectural office and with amazing people surrounding you, it was, of course, in the beginning not easy, but I am quite glad that I took that risk and restarted my career with my own company. And since 6 years, we are entering through this door in the center of Istanbul, and our office is in the top floor of this historical building. And I recognize in time that I am dealing with quite contemporary architectural issues in my life. And what a coincidence that all these buildings that I spent all my day, almost 24/7, are historical buildings. And actually, before going into detail of the projects, I would like to also show you the way how we create a dialogue between nature, technology, and architecture, because this is quite important why we are dealing with all these technological developments in a, maybe some people they call they are new, some people they call they are innovative, but at the end of the day, they are the tools which our century is providing us to use them. And first of all, we believe if we look at in a short history, like 300 years ago, people were working on the farm, and the technological development gave them this opportunity through farming. And that time, landowners were ruling the world. And almost 150, 200 years ago, people started working in factories because technology developed and the machines came into our lives. And people start working in the factories. And then, of course, the factory owners start ruling the world, and all these optimization and mass production process started. And we are now in the peak of this period. And today, actually, starting with the 21st century, of course, the data became one of the most important assets we have. And we are starting to become, in a way, the organizers of these data. Even we are architects or constructors or in any sector you are. So the data owners are already starting ruling our world, and they are deciding already for us in some senses, because the AI is also developing. And through all these, actually, the innovation is already in front of us, and we just need to, we believe that nature itself has the innovation, and we just need to find ways how to look at it, and we need to learn how to look at the nature. Nature is always new, and we deeply believe that nature is in some sense like the mother of architecture. We just need to look at it not as a semantic way, we need to look at nature in the sense of learning what is the system behind it, what are the organizational systems behind it, what are the algorithms. I mean, through just one section of a tree, you can really read the history of it. You can read the environmental conditions, which, what kind of environmental things happened through the, let's say, a century. You can just read through this rings of a tree. I mean, this is a very simple example, but this is the way also it's quite important how we start analyzing these informations. And luckily, in our century, we have technology, like also millions of years ago, they had technology. They found the fire, they found the stone, bronze, steel, and then steam engines, and then electrical engines, then automobiles, and now the data and information. Like, this is just developing, and we are really living in this, in my opinion, it's a good time to live in the history of human, but we need to really know how we can talk with the technology if we are seeking for a new options to develop our built environment. And in our generation, in my generation, of course, we in a way start getting our education in a digital world, like beginning of 2000, I was already at the university and I was doing my master degrees, and the digital world was already part of our education system. And in years, what I realized, and what we are also as a team in my office and also in my career at SA, I realized that we have been using these digital technologies in a way they were not meant to be produced for architects. We are still using some digital tools from actually aircraft designers, the CATIA, and later on, as some of you might know, that Frank Gehry, almost 20 years ago, they developed this software as part of also their company, and they called it Gehry Technologies and Digital Projects, and they were using also CATIA. And then some star architects, because of this very difficult construction methodologies, we also started using these softwares in our design and construction processes. Another program, Rhino, and this program is actually made mostly for the automobile sector to use to create these curved metal surfaces, double curvatures, to have optimized surfaces and stuff. And now it's part of our daily life in our office. We only use Rhino, Grasshopper, and this kind of softwares. And another one is, Steven also mentioned that Unreal Engine, this software is used actually for game sector. It's not made for architecture, but now we are using this also for our design development process. So, and robots. Now we start, I mean, robots are actually since a while in the world, they are used in different industries, like these other software that I was showing to you. They are in our daily life, we just don't see them. And people usually, in architectural sector, they start complaining, if the robots start taking roles in the construction site, then what's gonna happen to our, you know, jobs? Like, or even if in the office we are going to have, let's say, robotic arms in our offices. But they are already in the automobile sector, as an example, and they are, this lets people actually to get more advanced at what they are doing, in my opinion. And These technological, again, tools, in my opinion, they are just tools because they don't, they cannot replace, even though, let's say, AI is developing, they cannot really replace the way how we design, how we think, because it is something, I mean, I always believe that it starts with the designer, like as a human, as an architect with you. And these things, let's say 3D printers. 20 years ago, when I was doing my master's, there was a 3D printer at school, and it was a big thing, and it was so expensive, extremely expensive. And we were thinking that we are so lucky that we are using it. Nowadays, it's in our offices, and not only offices, like even the students in the high school, they can order from China and build at home and use these tools. And nowadays, it's available, this technology is available in our daily life because the materials are becoming cheap and they can be more like mass produced. And they are printing plastics, but not only plastics, people, they start printing also glass and metal. And we are using these VR, AR things, not only to showcase for some developers their residential buildings, actually we are also starting to use them during our design process. And robotic arms, like this. They were in the automotive sector or some other industries, but they are becoming now available also in our office desk. So it means that they are becoming cheaper and they are becoming more accessible. And we can also find ways to use them for our design as an architect through our design process. We just need to think about it and invent certain things. And I call it in a way, we are, as architects, we are so smart to misuse these tools from the purpose they were made, and we are, in a way, creating new reasons for them to move forward. And also, of course, drones. Drones are becoming also part of our daily life, plus they start also taking roles on our construction site. And behind these, all these things, like as architects, we always show very nice, when we first design a building, we always communicate with our clients or with other designers, with other architects, through these very nice images, which we call renderings. But actually, behind those images, in our office or in the offices that really use the information through from design to construction, actually you see this kind of screens, meaning that this is a collage of the information that we use. We need to develop a system to really control the whole process, not only design itself, we need to design the process, I believe. This means that you become, as an architect, actually, of course, the designer of the architect, but also the designer of the process, how it should be constructed. And so this requires, of course, this thing called BIM, Building Information Modeling. And you need to, of course, use these tools, these softwares, which are your best friends in the office, because they replace the white paper and the pen. I mean, you replace them with these smart softwares and you need to code them. Sometimes you need to really sit down and write specific codes for your project. And here I would like to show you one of the first projects that I worked on when I was at Zaha Hadid Architects. This was in Michigan. It's a small museum project. Sorry, I need to drink water while you are watching. And it's around 3,000 square meter, and it's it had this metal plated facade. And actually, the whole design of the facade and the concept of the project actually came from one very simple idea, that a museum needs natural lighting and, of course, artificial lighting. And we start designing according to natural conditions. Let's say different spaces require different lighting conditions, and the plates could really react to this information. So This basic idea, in a way, gave a shape not only to exterior of the facade composition, but also the whole structure of the building was accordingly designed. So they were, the program, the space, and architecture and structure were, in a way, collaborating between each other. And these are some of the images from the build-up. And it is active almost how many years? 7 years maybe. And when you go to US, you can visit it. And now I would like to take you to the journey of my office. This is one of our biggest projects in the office, and it is also one of the tallest buildings in Istanbul. It is under construction right now. It's Istanbul TV and Radio Tower project. The story of this project actually goes back to 2011. There, the government, metropolitan government in Istanbul, they opened a national competition, idea competition, to replace this junk here with one TV and radio tower. Actually, they built almost 40 years ago, they built a TV tower in Istanbul on the next hill. Our project is somewhere here on the Küçük Çamlıca Hill, like small Çamlıca Hill, and this is called the Big Çamlıca Hill. They built this tower, but back then they didn't really, it looks like they didn't do good planning for the feasibility planning for the telecommunication. And in years' time, of course, some development in technology and telecommunication, some other companies started putting their own antennas next to each other, and it started developing irregularly and sometimes maybe illegally. So they decided to open that competition. And I entered, and back then I was actually working in London, but I was about to change my career. And in 2013, I moved to Istanbul, but it was not announced that they're going to build this tower. Around 2014, towards the end, the government announced that they're going to build our TV and radio tower project. And then our big journey started, because it was a big collaborative project. There is some sound, but we can... Actually, this is a concept video for our project. It is 369 meters tall. It has this, for us, this project in a way reflects the collaboration and coordination between between architect and engineers. It's not, because this typology of buildings all over the world, usually they are known as masterpieces of engineers, not architects. And here we wanted to really combine these two things together, because our century is such a thing that you need to, it's not, it doesn't belong to one, in my opinion. Like, it's a collaborative work, and here we wanted to combine the design knowledge of architect with the design knowledge of engineers, especially, of course, structural engineers. And also, if you are designing such a tall building, you need to, for us, one of the most important design data was actually the environmental conditions, meaning that wind conditions. Here, it's on the, here you see the Bosporus, actually. This is called the Small Çamlıca Hill. It's already above 220 meters above the sea level, and it goes 369 meters high. And there are some public functions and technical functions here, and this is the antenna, the main antenna part, which is around 145 meters tall. And on the ground level, where the there is a park on the hill, and the podium area is actually happening in a way that you lift up the landscape one level up, and you put there all the entrance functions like foyer, ticketing, and this kind of functions. You can also walk on the roof in front of the plaza. You have some amphi areas here, and there are two panoramic elevators along the tower, which takes the visitors to the restaurant and observation levels. And hopefully, because we still not reached this part, but this is the foyer area. When you enter inside the podium area, hopefully this will be the first picture you will see. And as I mentioned, like there have been three major design data which used. One of them was the environmental data, meaning that the wind conditions, and because it was more important than the seismic. And we used this as really giving shape to the tower. And we wanted to take the typical engineering thing that they are, if, I mean, for them, it's very, the first thing they would do all over the world, you can see many examples of this, that they take the perfect conic concrete core, like a conic shape, and of course they put some sphere for the functions if it's required. We started from there, but by using this information, we start giving shape and we start deforming the building shape with this information, and also for the ground, for the podium area, we use the landscape geographical information. And to test this, we went to Toronto. There was a company called RWDI. They are one of the biggest companies who makes these wind turbine tests. So we went there, we did all kinds of different tests to make sure that our design proposal was really giving us the right information. So it was all confirmed, and then we were relieved to move on with all the detailing of the project. And again, like, this is what you see behind all this process. And also this, like, the shape of the building actually requires, this is from our BIM model, we are using as architectural office. We have been using for this project Revit. As a software to be able to communicate with all the engineers together, because here, besides being, I mean, as an architect, we were leading more than 25 different teams and engineering firms plus the consultants. And of course, we have been doing this in a smart way by using these technological tools, which, you know, are part of our design process. And here you can see, of course, some digital project management processes. Here, our model, but it's architectural model, structural facade, because we have only one core and everyone is working actually around that core. It's a very cylinder building, so you cannot really separate one information from the another one. Let's say when you design a high-rise office building, you can keep the facade main before later, and you can say, okay, even the client may say, okay, let's change the facade design. But in this building, you cannot do this because everything, all the information works together. Like, if you change something, the whole system is changing. And this means, let's say, usually when we first start designing any building, usually we start with this, you know, even when we make the physical models with papers or cardboard, we always start with this thin layer because we think abstractly. But when we do that, of course, as an architect, we also think for the later on what kind of facade build-up or structural build-up things are happening in a building. So this is the beautiful part which we communicate with all the citizens, but this is the reality which we are all dealing in. And our building is, as I said, it's under construction, and almost hopefully late 2019 or early 2020 it will be open for public use. During the process, construction process for the facade part, actually we were using unitized, I mean, it has an open facade system, so we were using unitized aluminium facade build-up, and on top of it we were putting another material which is called GRC, and they were all had to be done. There are almost 2,500 different panels all over the tower, and they are all single curved, and this was on purpose a decision for this building because we are in Turkey and there are of course very capable construction companies, but still there are certain things that it shouldn't be risked, especially economically. So that's why we took a decision to make it stepped and make it singular curved. But we were using, for the molds and stuff, it was the first time for this building we were using the robotic mold making, because each piece had to be, has a different mold and pouring this glass reinforced concrete in it. And here these drones, they didn't take role yet in this building, but I believe they will, and they will also take important role in our robotic science museum in Seoul. Here I was discussing with our client for a long time that, you know, each building has actually a BMU machine on top of it. And for this tower, it was a really, really big, big discussion, because I was telling them, like, technology is developing so much and so fast. And they had to, I mean, of course, there are government, I mean, in each country, of course, there are these legal processes that you have to submit your project, if it's especially a government project, and then the contractor comes in. But as an architect, you have to design every detail and submit it. But when you submit, when I submit this project to government with fully all details, it was end of 2016. And now we are in 2019, and they will finish hopefully in 2020. But technology developed so much for construction. I mean, they won't need anymore that BMU machine, at least for facade cleaning, you know, facade maintenance. Because there are companies now in the world that they are already doing, okay, for low rise, not maybe high rise as this building, but they, with drones, they do this facade maintenance stuff. And in 2 years' time, they will maybe even hold and, you know, put the panel on it. I mean, it's developing so impressively in a fast way. And while they are building the, our tower, of course we are building it, when they are building on site, we are building it in the office using our 3D printer. And for us, this is also a good experimenting, because we are using different materials and stuff each time for the, for each project we have. And we even take this further, let's say we take the information of the facade. This is because our tower has this amorph shape, and we called it, it is face of Asia and face of Europe, because both of them have different deformations. And when we unfold our facade, we get actually these two different, in a way, patterns, because it's just the geometrical translation of your project. And this is a current moment of our project. Actually, I will show you now, for me, one of the most interesting things of this project. And it is here, you see, we are here because actually we first built this concrete core, which is around 200 meters tall, and then we built the steel antenna. And the steel antenna was built inside this core, so we lift it up along the core above. And later on, we split the whole building into seven segments. Each segment we called lifting up one, lifting up two, three, four, five, six. And here, each of them, I mean, the first one was 3 floors high. The second one was 4 floors. They are each, I mean, especially this one was around 1,500 tons, meaning that you have 1,200 cars, let's say, you are lifting up along this concrete core. So actually, we build up these things along the core, I mean, on the ground level, and with everything finished except the interior details, like all the facade glazing, facade-related everything is finished. For the floors, we put the trapeze thing, and then it's ready to move on. So each part takes almost 2 months to build down, and then lifting up process takes 4 days. Like each time lapse you saw, they were like, Yeah, the first one was 5 days, second one 4, because of course the distance is getting shorter. So here we have another 140 meter, but this will be easier for us because the most difficult part was this part, because it had spaces like the restaurant areas, the technical areas were inside. This was one of the first renderings we did, and this is the current situation, as you see. And this picture we took last week from the restaurant level. This is how we will, if you come to Istanbul and if you visit this tower, this will be one of the views that you will see from the tower. And yeah, hopefully soon it will be opened and we will all go and visit. And our story continues, which I would like to show is this Seoul Robot Science Museum. Towards the end of 2018, Seoul Metropolitan Government announced an international competition for this project. And when we heard about it, of course, I was quite excited because there were three, for me, most important words were inside this project name: robots, science, and museum. So we said, okay, we will take risk and enter this project competition. We did, and in February 2019, they announced us as the winner of the project. And for us, we wanted to create really something. It's regarding the square meters, this is not a big museum project, actually. It's around 10,000 square meters. But what it's trying to do is quite important, and in a way, some people say it's innovative, because we didn't want this just to be a museum which exhibits the robots inside. We wanted to, if Korea, I mean, when you look at the Korea, they are South Korea, they are really developed in this robotic technologies, and especially in AI. Regarding the construction robotics, they are developing themselves, but regarding, on the other hand, for AI, they are the top one in the world. So for them, imagine that it's not an exhibition space, it's a museum. So this reflects in a way their position in the world for such a technological thing. We said, okay, let's don't only exhibit the robots, also we can give the robots some roles during the construction of this building. And in a way, the museum can start its first exhibition actually with its own construction process on the site. This was our main idea through this project. And we wanted to create a non-spherical universe for these robots, because